Thank you. Check, 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 check.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Stephen McLeod, and I'm the Director of Library Programs, and it's my pleasure to welcome everyone to the Fred W. Smith National Library for the Study of George Washington. I want to begin by thanking our sponsor, the Ford Motor Company, who's generously underwritten this series, and it's great to see so many people out supporting our program. It's my great pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Kathleen Bartoloni Tuazon. She received both her B.A. and Master of Library and Information Science from the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana. She received her Master's in City Planning from the University of California at Berkeley, and earned her Master's of Philosophy in History and her Ph.D. in History from the George Washington University. She's currently a visiting scholar with the First Federal Congress Project. She's also served as an international liaison for the Friends of the Earth, a production manager with City Sports Monthly, a research and teaching associate with the Department of Forestry and Resource Management at the University of California, Berkeley, a director of River Greenways Program with the California State Lands Commission, director of Natural Diversity Database, California Department of Fish and Game, and Chief Branch of Information Management with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Management Service. She's here tonight to talk about her new book, for fear of an elective king, George Washington, and the presidential title controversy of 1789. So please join me in a warm Mount Vernon welcome for Kathleen Bartoloni Tuazon.
Well, good evening. I have to say that I'm very excited to be here tonight. I want to thank Stephen for that wonderful introduction. I forgot everything that I've done in my life. I came to the interest in history a little bit later in my life, and I just couldn't get enough, and I couldn't get what I wanted. So I went to the George Washington University in Washington, D.C., and they very nicely took me on. And I've always been interested in leadership, and I've worked for several different wonderful leaders in my life, in business and in government. And our country's first leader was particularly interesting to me. So I want to welcome you all here tonight, and I want to thank you very much for coming to hear me speak about my book, For Fear of an Elective King. In the early spring of 1789, and within weeks of the first session of Congress, a dispute erupted over how to address the president. The Senate majority favored a lofty title, while the House stood unanimously opposed to anything more than the simple President of the United States. Congress, the press, and individuals throughout the country debated over 30 titles, most with royal overtones, mostly various forms of highness or majesty. In a world full of monarchs, the eventual resolution of the title controversy in favor of the simple president remained far from certain. When the Senate convened the next day, May 9th, the new title committee promptly recommended the imposing honorific, His Highness, the President of the United States of America and Protector of the Rights of the Same. This august appellation dropped like a proverbial lead balloon on the Senate chamber. Pandemonium erupted on the Senate floor as everyone seemed to speak at once. The most avid advocates of a grand title pressed their case, while others called for caution. Several panicked senators frantically agitated against hasty measures and demanded postponement of a final vote. It was all too much for John Adams, president of the Senate, who kindled at his supposed ally, Ralph Izzard, for supporting that postponement. Adams stood to dress down the senators and find fault with everything almost. And he even implied during his lengthy harangue that they act on their own without the House. He seemed in despair of being able to get it done, and so he wanted it done solely by the Senate. He pressed for immediate action in favor of an exalted title, emphasizing the adverse effect of a simple honorific on the dignity of the executive. What will the common people? What will the sailors and soldiers say? George Washington, president of the United States. They will despise him to all eternity. Mine is the story of the early Washington administration and the country's struggle with and cautious acceptance of executive power. Just what kind of a president did the people and the country want and need? The fight over the presidential title was hardly frivolous, as you could maybe tell by that reading. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've listened to one historian or another lecture about George Washington and the early presidency and warm up the audience with those titles from the title controversy. The Senate wanted His Highness, the President of the United States and protector of their liberties. John Adams was so ridiculed for favoring a title that he got one of his own, his rotundity. Say you gotta laugh. But the question of executive leadership within a popular sovereignty was a complicated one. Okay, I'm gonna give this a try now. The presidency was a very, The presidency was a very controversial position. The Revolutionary War was fought against a British king, George III. Yet just 6 years after the Treaty of Paris and the end of the war, the untried Constitution featured a broadly defined, singular central executive for whom some in Congress wanted a grand title. Also, there were no term limits on the president. So it's no wonder that the office alarmed critics of the Constitution and of the proposed government because of its resemblance to monarchy. To make matters worse, the vaguely defined powers of the president in the Constitution led to conflicting interpretations and fears of either dangerous strength or disastrous weakness. The new presidency forced Americans to find an acceptable balance between elite power and the people's sovereignty. Complicating these questions was George Washington, America's first president. Washington was immensely popular, and his celebrity represented both a blessing and a curse for the presidency. He was the unanimous, most trusted choice for president, but the enthusiasm and reverence shown to him threatened the presidency with monarchical undertones. This painting, part of which is on the cover of my book, actually, captures the popular enthusiasm for Washington. An enthusiasm that elicited a kind of rapture in the people. This shows Washington's arrival in New York City on April 23rd, a week before his inauguration on April 30th. The artist actually did a fairly accurate job of showing Washington's elegant barge, which he rode on as he approached the city from the Hudson River. The artist's romantic, sentimental, and somewhat naive style captured the joy of the welcoming crowd. Notice the red, white, and blue of the flag present on the barge. Red canopy, 13 white-clad oarsmen representing the colonies or states. George Washington in a blue suit. The color of the canopy also suggests the royal red of kings and has a somewhat elegant tone. Washington's arrival was a huge event. Lots of cannon fire and people, red carpet on the steps of the wharf. It was so noisy that a school of porpoises surfaced in the river and followed the barge as if to see what was going on and be a part of the celebration. As one observer said, as if to see what was the cause of all this joy. By far the most famous and trusted American political personality of the time. Of the time, and perhaps any time, Washington commanded respect for the young nation and provided legitimacy for its Republican experiment. But even before he arrived in New York City, questions began to circulate about how to address Washington as president. He had already held the title of Excellency when he was Commander-in-Chief of the Revolutionary Forces. He retained that title as well as his military title of General. He was addressed as Excellency and General all the time, by just about everyone. In addition, titles remained a part of post-revolutionary society, especially for governors, who were all addressed as either Your Excellency, or in the case of Georgia, it was in the Constitution that he should be Your Honor or Honorable. In addition to titles, there were titles for a lot of local offices, from clerks to judges, and they were springing up everywhere as everyday people felt they deserved titles too, to be more on a par with the social, political, and military elites. So should the new office of the president have a title equal to or higher than Excellency, which was already used for the governors, and by the way, also used for the president of the Confederation Congress? This painting was done in 1788 and is considered a pretty good likeness of Washington just before he took office. As you can see, his military garb is elegant but somewhat restrained. Now, look at the next slide. It's basically based on the same outfit. As the inauguration neared, anticipation of Washington's presidency fed the uproar about a title. Considering his popularity, it's really no wonder that one of the titles considered was the title of Washington. As President Washington helped Americans feel secure about the office, and looking back to a time when Caesar became the title for subsequent Roman emperors, some thought that the title of Washington would be the best way to assure that his virtues and prestige might pass to his successors. This image of Washington is from 1850, when it's actually painted by the son of the artist in the previous painting. I think this painting of Washington with the military epaulets and neck scarf in a slightly grander rendition than the one from the contemporary, the one that we saw earlier, does a nice job, whether it meant to or not, of kind of showing that Caesar, Washington as Caesar mentality. To the Washington as Caesar comparison, title opponents argued that their military hero, Revolutionary War hero, had not fought against the British king just to have a crown of his own. Those in favor of a simple title dreaded a kingly president. But there was actually a good case to be made on the other side as well. Many Americans believed a strong title would guard against the risk that a weak executive would become the corrupt tool of a powerful few, especially influential elites in the Senate or foreign powers. An important voice on this side of the title argument was John Adams, Washington's vice president and president of the Senate. Adams worried that an American aristocracy would emerge from the Senate and that it would overwhelm the new national leader, much as a royal court could manipulate and corrupt its king. And one way to guard against this would be a grand title. Americans' governors already held the title of Excellency or Honorable, and so as far as Adams was concerned, the chief executive would need something grander. As for the use of the unadorned president, Adams was full of contempt. After all, there were presidents of fire companies and cricket clubs. For Adams, nothing would do but Highness, Most Benign Highness, or Majesty. His advocacy of such a high address ultimately hurt him and gained him that derisive title of His Rotundity. He alarmed his revolutionary cohorts and his close friends. He lost political influence, and he came to be seen as a tacit monarchist. George Mason also worried about the dangers of a weak president, one capable of being corrupted by state elites or foreign powers. Mason's concern about powerful and corrupt elites in the Senate in particular was one of the main reasons he refused to sign the Constitution at the Philadelphia Convention. He predicted that the president would become a tool of the Senate, wrote about it, and published his ideas far and wide during the ratification process, and influenced many anti-federalists with his opinion. Yet, although Mason and anti-federalists worried about corruption overtaking the president, they didn't feel, like Adams, that the answer was a grand executive title. Mason hated the pomp on the federal scene and actually called Adams one of those damned monarchical fellows out to ruin the nation. His main solace was his old friend Washington. Even though Mason and Washington had become estranged over their different opinions about the Constitution. During the title controversy, Mason said, "By God, if the president was not an uncommon man, we would soon have the devil to pay." Mason still trusted Washington as president. And indeed, one of Washington's constant concerns while president was whether he was doing anything to upset Mason and others in Virginia and the rest of the country who had resisted the Constitution and distrusted the presidency. During the title controversy, Adams suffered the misery of the slings and arrows of critical opinion. He was the butt of jokes and called his rotundity, mostly that was among his colleagues in the political elite. Even more damaging and widespread, he became known as the Dangerous Vice, a title derived from a long poem by Edward Church entitled The Dangerous Vice, dash, 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 dash. And if you count the dashes, it's just enough to spell out the word president. The popular poem linked the evils of the vice of monarchy with Vice President Adams, a heartbeat away from the presidency. He was the spawn of hell in this poem. He was dreaming of a crown of his own. The criticism of Adams spilled over onto his wife, Abigail. She complained to her sister about the libel for such as it is called the Dangerous Vice. Even more galling, the poem's handling of Washington portrayed the president as a sterling example of American leadership. Virtuous Washington, who never basely bartered for a paltry crown. Abigail chafed at the poem's comparison of the Republican Washington and the Royalist Adams. And quite indelicately, the poem had not spared Abigail. Criticizing her and other women on the federal scene as elites who never walked and instead always rode around in fancy carriages. Abigail thought the writer was a brute to attack me who never in thought, word, or deed offended him. Adams' main ally in the Senate, as he pushed for a high title, was Virginia Senator Richard Henry Lee. Fears of a weak executive becoming the tool of an influential few in the Senate drove his push for an exalted title, too. When Adams broached the question of how to address the president, Senator Lee moved that a committee produce a title recommendation. Some of the titles that the Senate considered included Highness, Elected Highness, and Elected Majesty. Richard Henry Lee didn't suffer the abuse heaped on Adams. He escaped the worst of it because Lee quickly moved on to his main issue and going to Congress in the first place, which was amendments to the Constitution. And on this issue, he was on the same side as those who opposed the grand title for the president. So, also, we have to admit, Adams provided a pretty large target, and he just drew attention away from anyone else. Okay, try it. Here's a hand-colored engraving of Federal Hall in New York City in 1790, done by Amos Doolittle. It's a favorite of mine. I really like it. It's a tragedy they tore down that building. Both the Senate and the House met here. The Senate, in particular, found itself in a bind when it came to the issue of the presidential title. The senators risked being labeled as monarchists if they favored a strong title, but if they didn't give a strong title to what many considered to be a weak executive, they risked being damned as aristocrats out to subvert the authority of the new national leader. The Senate went on record to recommend the title of His Highness the President of the United States of America and Protector of their liberties, which senators saw as keeping with global title conventions. Although they recommended this title in the final resolution, they resolved to address the president simply as president without a grand title. The loudest and oftest lone voice in the Senate against grand titles was William McClay, senator from Pennsylvania. He wanted no title other than the name of the civic office as it was stated in the Constitution, that of president. McClay considered John Adams his nemesis in the Senate. Their barely civil confrontations over lofty titles contained the stuff of high drama, especially when McClay was writing about it in his diary, which was published at the end of the 19th century and is why we know a lot about this today. McClay considered Adams a monkey just put into breeches and blamed Adams and his high priest, Richard Henry Lee, for this whole idolatrous business of titles. McClay abhorred a grand executive title and its royal connotations and believed he had the public on his side, and indeed a majority of Americans agreed with him. In addition to McClay, Virginia Representative James Madison and all of his colleagues in the House of Representatives opposed a high title for the president from the very beginning, adamantly and unwaveringly. James Madison served as Washington's closest collaborator during his first year as president. We often hear about the Madison and Jefferson friendship and the Washington-Hamilton connection, and that's, they're often pitted against each other. But in those early years of the presidency, remember, it was Washington and Madison that were both at the Philadelphia Convention when they were writing the Constitution. Adams wasn't there, he was in England, and Jefferson wasn't there, he was in France. Madison and Washington bonded, and they had very strongly held opinions about the propriety of the Constitution, and they were very much in favor of it. So during this period in the early presidency, we can look to Madison and what Madison had to say, and where Washington is circumspect, at times you can think of Madison as really Washington's voice on many matters, including the title controversy. In fact, in a coded letter to Thomas Jefferson, Madison hinted at the depth of the president's relief at the outcome of a simple title. Had the project succeeded, he wrote, it would have subjected the president to a severe dilemma and have given a deep wound to our infant government. Washington mentioned his unhappiness with both Adams and the title campaign in a letter to his friend, confidant, and family member, Dr. David Stewart. In 1783, David Stewart married Eleanor Calvert Custis, who you see here, the widow of Martha Washington's son, John Park Custis. And thus, David Stewart became an integral and trusted part of the Washington family. Washington wrote to Stewart, "The truth is, the question of a title was moved before I arrived in New York, without my privity or knowledge, and urged after I was apprised of it, contrary to my opinion. I foresaw and predicted the reception it has met with and the use that would be made of it by the adversaries of this government." Washington was upset. He was especially upset at Adams. "It is to be lamented," he wrote, "that he and some others have stirred a question that has given rise to so much animadversion." Washington was hugely relieved with the final outcome of nothing grander than the civic title of president. "Happily," he wrote, "the matter is now done with. I hope never to be revived." On May 14, 1789, the Senate capitulated to the House's wish for the modest and unadorned President of the United States, offering the people some relief from the fear that the President might become an elective king. I've put a few parts of the resolution, which it's all right here, in bold. First, you can see it, that they report that it's in their opinion that the title of Highness President of the United States, Protector of Their Liberties, is appropriate. But then they resolve, and I love this part, I put it in bold just because it's so rare. "The Senate, desirous of preserving harmony with the House." Doesn't that sound great? Wouldn't you love to be able to see that today? "The Senate, desirous of preserving harmony with the House of Representatives, resolves that the president's address to be the President of the United States without addition of title." So May 14th was the end of the legislative struggle over the presidential title, but just the beginning of the public debate. Remember, the Senate met behind closed doors. When the resolution became public knowledge, the newspapers and other forums like letters and broadsides erupted into a months-long version of today's Twitter issue gone viral. For example, the poem, The Dangerous Vice, Washington's letter to Stewart, these things happened in the summer. The Dangerous Vice came out in August. Washington's letter to Stewart was in July. I mean, during the time when the legislature was meeting, he was very circumspect. Once Stewart found out about it, he wrote to him and said, "What's this about a title?" Which is why then Washington wrote that letter back. This is during the public debate. From letters to broadsides to plays and poems, everyone had an opinion about titles. The public phase was fierce and mostly unknown to historians until my book. Contrary to Adams's fear that a humble civic title and nothing more would diminish the office, Washington and the office began to elevate the simple title. Over time, Washington's name, accompanied by the simple title of president, atop treaties and proclamations, endowed the civic title of president with a sense of power and command. The modest title of president quelled fears of an elective king and bolstered confidence in the new government. However, the controversy formed the leading edge of increasingly partisan battles over presidential power that continue to this day. It also continued the movement toward equality and democracy in society and away from designations of status. It also resulted, I feel, in the total and kind of immediate casualty of the professional relationship of the presidency to the vice presidency. John Adams's unpopularity over the whole titles campaign caused Washington to back away from him in his role as vice president. Also, Adams himself devalued his role of vice president in favor of his role as Senate watchdog. Ironically, his sacrifice of the vice presidency empowered the president to dominate the executive branch and helped create the energetic leader that Adams had sought through a grand title. The presidential title dispute was the first battle over the role of the American president, whose place at the head of the country, with the enormous potential as the United States had, quickly instilled power and prestige in the office despite, and more significantly because of, the unadorned title of president, since people were more comfortable with the office without an exalted title attached to it. As people became more accepting of the office, and also as Washington backed away from Adams, the ultimate legacy of the title controversy is actually an expansion and consolidation of executive power. Within the limits placed upon the president that governing within a popular sovereignty brings. Foremost of these limits are the people's demand for restraint, which they got with the simple title, and for an acknowledgement of their will from the country's leader, evident by Washington's opposition to a grand title. One of the things that we learn from the title controversy is that the question of executive leadership in a popular sovereignty is a tricky proposition. You know, Mount Vernon and elsewhere are fond of pointing out the various ways that George Washington had a long-term effect on the presidency. But I feel these lists are missing something. I feel they should include what I call the first principles of American executive leadership, as established by Washington and the people with the resolution of the title controversy. These first principles are a required modesty in the president established by the decision supported by Washington favoring the simple title of president, and an acknowledgement of the interdependence that must exist between the people and their leader within the constitutional system. Washington's stance against a grand title mirrored the bulk of popular opinion. Thus, we see Washington living these principles by his stance with the people favoring a simple title. Some would say that the modern presidency, basically since the 20th century, has moved away from these principles. However, I think that the efforts that modern presidents go to appear like one of us, whether it's playing the saxophone, hating broccoli, remember that? Loving football and clearing brush, playing basketball, all of these traits harken back to the principle of modesty and simplicity, although in today's parlance, it's usually called relatability. Washington's continued popularity largely stemmed from his ability, I believe, to apprehend and reflect the pulse of popular opinion. Long before he became president, Washington had learned to respect the era's egalitarian ideals. I mean, he was in Virginia when Virginia barely ratified the Constitution. He's listening to his best friend, one of his best friends, George Mason, talk against the Constitution. All right, he had learned that these egalitarian ideals were somewhat challenged by the Constitution, and he respected that people's opinions mattered. Despite the use of titles that still remained in society, as he assumed the Republic's highest office, Washington reflected, "The eyes of America, perhaps of the world, are turned to this government, and many are watching the movements of all those who are concerned in its administration." And perhaps no one was watched more closely than Washington. This version of a studiously and overtly Republican President Washington, standing in his plain suit with his hand on what may be the Constitution, sent a message of power coupled with modesty and a reference to the people, hand on the Constitution. Other paintings of the president from this period often contained a similar ideal of presidential leadership. Now, this is the Monroe Lennox portrait with his hand on the Constitution. You're probably very familiar with the Lansdowne painting. In that one, there's a slightly different background, and his hand is outstretched as if he's gesturing to the people. The same kind of message. And the same very plain garb. You know, Washington worried that he would become linked with the advocacy of a grand title, one of the many reasons that he backed away from Adams. But this didn't happen when he was alive. However, it did happen in the 1850s, when journalist Rufus Griswold published a rumor that Washington had favored the title of High Mightiness. How many of you have heard that rumor? Perhaps some of you have read it in different books. I found this claim to be completely unsupported by the title controversy evidence. What we know is that Washington argued against a high title for the president and worked against it behind the scenes, especially with Madison. And there's also no evidence he ever recommended any title, High Mightiness, Mr. President, anything. And yet the unsubstantiated claim about Washington favoring High Mightiness is still making the rounds. Noted historians still sometimes mention that Washington favored High Mightiness and use Rufus Griswold from 1850s as a source, calling this journalist's book as a work of historical mischief, which some people have done, is kind as far as I'm concerned. The title Mr. President, so commonly heard at televised news conferences today, never attached to Washington, who continued to be addressed as Sir, General, and Excellency until the end of his days. But with the resolution of the title controversy, Mr. President would be the way of the future, not just as a formal title, but also as a guiding notion for organizing the trappings of that powerful office. Today, accusations of an imperial presidency continue a long-standing inclination for protectiveness toward the office and a preference for simplicity and a need to get a nod to the people from their president. And it attests how hard it is to determine the proper role for this increasingly formidable type of world leader. Well, thank you very much for listening. I just wanted to say you've been a great audience. Thank you so much. You laughed at my jokes. I appreciate it. and thanks once again to Stephen and the people here at Mount Vernon at the library. I'd be glad to try and answer any questions you might have. Yes, sir?
Yeah, Martha Washington was called Lady Washington.
Yes, she was.
Did Abigail Adams have any sort of...
Well, you know, Abigail Adams, interestingly enough, because she was the wife of an ambassador, you know, Adams was ambassador to England, she was called Your Excellency. So was Adams. Adams was used to being called Excellency when he was in England. And in fact, there are instances, which I mention in the book, of like Abigail Adams receiving letters from friends in England, and it's to Her Excellency, Abigail Adams. Sure. And, you know, all the ladies, women on the federal scene were referred to as lady in the press, not just Lady Washington. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that Washington had opposed the idea of a title, but that he did this fairly behind the scenes. You know, I was sort of torn while listening to you and trying to figure out why it was, given the great respect for Washington, that there was even an issue once his views became known. Was he so subtle about getting his views out that people were not aware of it?
I'll tell you, as most of the people who were against the title had complete faith that he was against it too, based on his former behavior, but he never said anything. You know, he was very circumspect. I mean, in private discussions with James Madison, he may have said something. James Madison on the House floor spoke against the title of High Mightiness himself. He said it wasn't, you know, it wasn't powerful at all. But Washington never said anything to the public at large. Now, some of the leaders, obviously, John Adams must have been told by Washington. Washington implies in that letter that he told Adams to stop. And Adams went ahead anyway. In spite of being George Washington, and he still wasn't a general, you know, anymore. He wasn't getting his way. Yeah, some people must have known, but it didn't stop this movement. And the movement started before he arrived. The Senate committee was already formed before he even got to New York and found out about it. So, by the time he made his views known, the ball was rolling. Does that answer your question? Yes, ma'am?
Oh, thanks. I'm a former resident of Quincy, Massachusetts, so this is fun for me. But two questions. Despite who was the vice president at the time, was there any consideration that a grand title would also transfer to the vice president? And what did the rest of the world think? Before and after, how did the rest of the world feel about president?
There were several different titles suggested for the vice president in the press, and in the initial titles committee was supposed to figure out a title for both the president and vice president, but they were having so much problems just coming up with a title for the president that they had subsequent subcommittees, and those subsequent committees just focused on trying to get the president one solved, which they couldn't really do. But Excellency was one of the titles. Most honorable, as opposed to honorable, was considered. Washington there was another one of his supremacy, and then magistracy. You know, they're trying to come up with all these things, and then vice magistrate for the vice president. I mean, there was a lot of different ideas out there. As the controversy moved on, it just became more about the president's title than it did the vice president, because if they couldn't get that, they couldn't get anything. As far as other countries, people worried about what other countries were thinking, but they were kind of far away. No one was commenting about the title controversy, except for like the French minister who was based in the United States. And he said, well, some people want to get a title and make Washington a king. And his comment was, he's already kind of a king the way people treat him, but I don't think they're going to give him that, give him the name Highness, you know, because, and they, and in those letters that the French minister writes, he says that John Adams is becoming very unpopular with his, ideas. Yes?
Good evening. Perhaps I might have missed it. Was the term president, though, were there other countries that had a president that was and that was aligned to a type of government prior to this, and which they borrowed from?
There were no countries in the world whose main leader was called president. There, the reason High Mightiness, I think, was considered as one of the titles was that was being used in the Netherlands. And the Netherlands was considered more of a republic than some of the other countries that had kings. But no, there were no, republics. And the republics that had been Rome and it had been Caesar, you know, they'd been emperors. So no, this was such an experiment. It was really an experiment. And people felt protective of the government. And also there was an awful lot of people who, you know, it was sort of like the country's self-esteem wasn't real high. You know, we were worried about how we were going to be viewed on the world stage. And they didn't want Washington, who everyone revered, to be ridiculed by other world leaders. But it just didn't happen. I mean, Washington had so much prestige that he brought to the office that, as I said, the president of the United States, that term, you know what kind of power and prestige that word has today, you know. So, yes, sir.
When did they start attaching the honorable to congressmen and senators? Do you know that?
Not in the first administration. What did happen was that the House of Representatives in their journal was even using the word Esquire in their journal, and they actually voted to stop using Esquire in their journal. Okay, so there were a couple of times when honorable was going to be put into the Senate journal, and there was opposition to that. So in the journals, you won't see those titles because it was a very sensitive issue. They were calling each other honorable all the time, and especially also in the House, which was open. And there are a lot of there's a lot of commentary during the public phase of the title dispute where people are very cynical, saying, well, the House was against it, but they keep calling themselves honorable in all their debates in Congress. So it happened later. But the writing was on the wall.
I was wondering if you had any thoughts on the confusion that sort of developed in some circles over who's first president, in the sense that under the Articles of Confederation, that the title was president, and in Congress, and even though they're not the same office at all.
Well, you know, I always say Washington was the first president of the constitutional era. You know, I mean, the constitutional era starts with the federal constitution. There was a president of the Confederation Congress. He was a president of Congress. He wasn't a president of the United States. So there was a president of Congress, and that is definitely true. And he changed every year. They had a different person every year. And as you probably know, you applied it. He was basically, it was very administrative. He was just a figurehead. but he was called Excellency. For a figurehead, he was still given quite a lot of respect. But once they were going to have a president of the United States and not a president that represented the people, not just the president of Congress, then having someone referred to as Excellency became an issue. You know, I think that's very interesting that they could call among these elites in the Confederation Congress, they could call their president Excellency if they wanted and call themselves honorable. But as soon as we have a president that represents the people of all the states, the sensitivity revolving around that position and what that position represented changed. And whether we can give him any title at all became quite a big issue. Anything else? Sure. Well, thank you again. I had a great time. Just wonderful to be here, and I just live in Vienna, so I'll probably see you again because I'm going to come to some of the other talks now. Thank you. Thank you.
I want to thank our speaker for such an outstanding lecture. I want to let everyone know that we have books for sale out in the hallway, and our speaker will be here in the front to sign copies of the book if you'd like to have her sign one. All right, thank you.
Thank you.